you know, the war breaks down into two pieces, mm-hmm. the army and the victims. Mm-hmm. Always the victims are women and children. Aren't they part of the war?
Wow.
What are you saying this for? You know, who are you? And he amazed me in his explanation. And I was sitting there with these two women, one of who had deep experience in war, one who knew very much about war, and watching them, in their reaction, they were astounded at this person. And they were astounded that there were people who were actually just believing it and accepting it, as if it makes any sense at all whatsoever. Mm-hmm. This is the same person who tells you that we should be going constantly to our wailing wall in Washington, Vietnam Monument, weeping for our 60,000.
Well, that's also to say that war is only this thing that happens when a politician calls it a war.
That's right.
Implies that we're not in the war all the time.
The missing half is what about the 400 million, what about the 4 million dead people we left behind in Indochina? Mm. You know, who speaks for them? Mm. So I got really interested in the way these women were reacting to this guy, and I decided I should try to write that. Mm. And I started doing it. Mm. And it's been an amazing experience for me. Mm. But that's how that subject just comes
out. And how are you following the subject through? Unless I'm invading.
No. Yeah. I mean, it's an ongoing thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's fascinating to me to hear So where are you with it now?
Well, to me, it starts out as the woman, as the other, because women are other, right? Mm-hmm. In the world, in a war particularly, but it's not. It's very much about acknowledging the other and then following the other into humanity. Mm-hmm.
Well, the other is myself. The other is myself,
right,
as well.
Until the other disappears, mm-hmm. and you realize mm-hmm. that just all these things that we expect of women in the world, just as many things we expect of ourselves in the world, these are all false. Mm-hmm. We've created these dichotomies that don't exist.
Talk about it a little bit. What do you think we've created?
Well, if I'm talking in the context of war, I see that, for example, a woman who's in a war. Mm-hmm. is in a war just as much as a man is in a war. Mm. And it really angers me that there are people in Congress in our country who want women to carry guns and kill people instead of wanting the men to put down their guns and stop killing people. I mean, it's like, make the other half of this population more like the bad half than the other way around. I mean, I just don't get it. Do you get it? Mm-hmm. I don't get it. But I know that it has to do with the weapons industry, and that's the whole thing. But no, so it's really very abstract and hard to talk about, but I'm learning a lot. And then I realize, how much I love women, right? Mm-hmm. How many times I've been in love in my life. Mm-hmm. And so it just has to go, and then where does that come from? And what does that mean? And how does that affect us and our consciousness now in the world? Because the world's falling apart, and we're not going to get it back together by being divisive, right? It's not going to help for men and women to go farther apart, is it? But boy, it seems like the government sure would like that. That's another subject altogether. So
when you're working, I want to ask you a little bit more about process. This is an incredible opportunity. When you're working on this poem, I mean, do you organize your thoughts about it? Do you think about it all day long? How do you write a poem about this? What's your methodology?
This one's just obsession. Mm-hmm. I just always just worked on it constantly. Mm-hmm. I just worked on it.
You worked on the words.
Constantly. Mm-hmm. I wake up and I write until I went to sleep. Mm-hmm. Or fell over.
How many words? How many words were there?
I don't know because.
A page, six pages.
No, sometimes I work all day on one sentence. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, so. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not a very prolific writer. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just takes me a long time to write. Mm-hmm. And so I probably throw it all out and start over again when it's done. Maybe, but I don't think so. I think it's about finished. Mm-hmm. So I've been working on a concentrated effort of working on it for about 8 months, and that's, I think it's finished. Mm. All right, I don't think it's finished. I don't know about you, but sometimes I just feel like I just have to abandon it because it abandons me. Mm. And then it doesn't necessarily make linear sense either. This is not a piece that goes from A to B to C to D. Mm. To me, it's just zigzagging around, moving around, because I'm trying to find something in here. I'm trying to figure out a problem. I'm trying to learn something about a subject, which I realize I know more about than I thought and less about than I thought.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I, it's, and so that's an interesting process. I don't know if it's similar to putting a building together. You start with an empty space and you put something there. But poetry doesn't have the same kind of function, that that utilitarian function that anything physical such as a building would have.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you say, you get up and you work on nothing all day long. Right? I mean, not nothing to you, but you know, you're making
very much nothing.
But they both come from the same place. They come from ideas.
Yeah.
In terms of its usefulness,
yeah.
You know, materially it might be something.
Yeah, yeah. Sure.
But you know, I keep going back to realities that I can touch, that are not so far in the past, and how they attach themselves to some of what we need to spring from today. Like, I was with a group of young people the other day from Art Center School of Design, and we were talking about design concepts and that kind of thing. And we eventually acknowledged the fact that 3/4 of the cost of a product is in the packaging.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you go in a supermarket and all you want is to purchase some fish.
Yeah.
And you pay for the cost of the way the fish is packaged.
Mm-hmm.
When I grew up, you went to Mrs. Jones's fish market and you took some newspaper with you, right? You set it on the counter. And when Mrs. Jones weighed out the fish, you put it on the newspaper and you wrapped the fish and you took it with you, right? When you wanted a chicken, if you didn't raise it, most of the times you did, where I grew up, you know, a chicken was a pecking thing that walked around making corn. You would have to entice it in some way to catch it when your mother said, go out and get a chicken for, you know, and you'd have to entice it. But, like, it's presented in another form now in the market. So we cut ourselves away from real stuff,
sure. Mm-hmm.
The real stuff of life, you know. And so how long do we go on teaching things like the fine technique of package design, which is totally unnecessary in some cases.
In many cases.
When we want a simple food item, or just, you know, I mean, just things that you think about, things that you critique in your own way. But like you might toy with a sentence or a phrase or a paragraph for an eon, I'll have an idea and I'll try to exhaust that idea, which is impossible, by doing a series. So I work in groups of work, you know, if I have an idea. Like I did a piece a short time ago called The Missing Mule, right? It was an empty little wagon like element. And the power source was missing, the mule. So the second piece was In Search of the Missing Mule, you know. And that will go on and on and on until there's a mule series.
That's interesting.
You know what I mean? That's kind of how I do it right
yeah.
now. And I never heard that it was an ugly thing to become an artist. When that was very prevalent when I grew up, I didn't hear that from my family.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that when you practice crafts that are in disciplines that are affiliated with the arts, and you're serious about it. I always thought that was almost like being wounded with a blessing. Being wounded in some way with a blessing. You know, because you don't choose to feel necessarily the way you feel about things. It's placed with you, fortunately, in some way, or unfortunately. You know, I would do anything to keep from burlesquing my sensibility. I drove buses in Chicago and trains, and, you know, when I studied at the American Academy of Art. And I never saw my art as commodity. It's very difficult for me to think in terms of placing value on something that is so personal. Because I'm so fortunate when somebody else wants to share that. You know what I mean?
Yes.
But I've been fortunate enough to raise a family. and to live by holding on to a sheer stream that's strong enough, because I believe in it. Mm-hmm. The fact that it won't break, mm-hmm. you know, it's just part of how my umbilical cord hasn't broken yet. I'm still attached, you know, mm-hmm. and I'm fortunate. And I think that you're wounded with a blessing when you practice, and there's substance.
I completely agree with that. Even though I might have had this experience of being told that certain things were ugly when I was young, I did believe it.
Yeah.
And it never interrupted it, and it never stopped it, and I never got discouraged.
Right.
And I never listened to it. And
right.
I just go on, and it doesn't. As I get older, I get even more interested in it. It becomes more interesting to me. It becomes, we'll get to the point where I was saying I break down the form. And if I always work in series, too. I don't write single pieces anymore. Each section of the series is like, to me, a room you go in, another room, or a turn you take. It is or it isn't connected, but it's not something you expect. The next thing is not what you expect. The next thing is what I found. I didn't expect it either. And there's a great beauty in the whole process.
Mm-hmm.
I've been lucky also to have been able to survive this long just doing that. Without commercializing it, without having to. Well, I did write some ads once for a couple of weeks for somebody, and they were just unbelievable experience. But I learned something from that.
What'd you learn?
I learned never to write ads. Always get the money up front. And always ask for the products that you're writing about.
Okay.
I got a whole bunch of sweaters out of it. So.
Did you sell the products? Did the products sell because of your efforts?
It's funny because I tried to be as honest as possible. That kills an ad person all the time. I just don't like advertising, you know, so instead they asked me to write some ads for sweaters, so I wrote a history of sweaters. I thought that would be interesting. Well, histories of sweaters, where certain knots came from and how they were made, and they used them, but they fired me, you know, Your Honor. But I got the sweaters, and they paid me, and they published
them. Were they good sweaters?
I still have some of them. This was some years ago, yeah. And I guess they were good ads. I don't know. But no, you can't commercialize what you're doing if you're doing something that it's not done for that purpose. I mean, what's poetry for? Hey, I know what it's for. Nobody is, you know, beat down my door to get any of it, so it doesn't make any difference. It's what I love to do.
What is it for?
It's for everything, right? I mean, just for everything. I've never taught it to anyone. How do you teach something? I have young writer friends, young poet friends, and I talk to them. Most of my writer friends are not poets, so most of them are novelists or essayists, and I don't know why that is, but most of my poet friends live in foreign countries, but I have a number of young writer friends, much younger than me, poets, and we talk a lot about the process when they want to talk about it, but, you know, I think that, I don't know what you would say to your students, but, you know, they're not my students, but they're just people that I know who are young, and the only thing I can tell them is to get up every morning and face the wall. Just get up and sit down and work. And try to structure your life so that you can afford to do that. You know, lower your expectations materialistically. Forget about the clothing and the objects and the houses and the trips. Sit down and work. Make enough money to pay your rent and sit down and work. Eat once in a while.
That's it.
What's it for you, John?
What?
When he said, I asked him what poetry was for. He said it was for everything.
Oh.
Was it for you? Is that a fair question?
Well,
it is.
I don't separate it from whatever it is that I call art.
Mm-hmm.
I never found a way to separate that.
Mm, I hear this.
A song is at times one of the most important things in the entire existence of the universe. You know, I love the mockingbird because it comes to sing. That's the duty of the mockingbird. And it's like we had a little problem on the table the other day when I was with this group of students. The young instructor with them asked the question, what is it about art that you think is so important to the world? That's a frightening kind of question, you know. And the only thing that I could think of in an impromptu sense was to say, as slowly as I could say it, and as thoroughly as I could say it, let us start to subtract what we might call art from our experiences. Let's steal all the colors, first of all. Let's build a cage for all the birds. You know what I mean? Let's go and wreck the flower gardens. You know what I mean? Let us get up tomorrow and discover the fact that there's not a song in the world to be heard. And not just tomorrow, or a picture. We just started to strip things. And after a while, what was called art started to grow into the pulse of light. You know, breath. The wind of John Coltrane flying through the atmosphere, sharing its tonality. The bounce of Beethoven. You know what I mean? And the dignity of the gift that it gives me, you know, to hear the symphonic theme that embraces, carries, and at times brushes away a tear, you know. So I see what we call art as being the sensibility that tells us how precious breath is. I mean, it's very important to know that you start to understand your pain in a very clear way. It's something that you can be thankful for, even because you feel it. And that's form, you know.
Hmm. And that's beautiful.
Feeling has more form than anything. I think that's where it all starts. Mm-hmm. And form has feeling. The form, the page that you said when the words refuse to cater to form in terms of presentation. Because art says that there's another step. There's another step to be taken. There's this one. But then there's the one in front of that, because that's the way the vision flies. The vision carries on and on and on. I'll tell you something that happened to me a few years ago that made me question myself in a very serious way. Back in the 60s, I was one of a group of artists who founded an organization called the Communicative Arts Academy in Compton. We were activist artists and renegades. We were part of the civil rights movement, but we were about art. We confronted the museums. I worked at the Pasadena Art Museum at the time, before it was the Norton Simon Museum. And I met people and worked very closely with people at times like Richard Serra. Even met Andy Warhol during that period, Rauschenberg. And enjoy just coming in contact with them, helping them solve insulation problems and that kind of thing. So it was a great period for me. But at the same time, the group of artists, Latino, Asian, African Americans, we found ourselves in the streets worrying about other ways of challenging this very rigid, well-established way of institutionalizing the arts. We were just outsiders, right? And that was all right. I mean, so we started to put together, as best we could, little institutions here and there. One young man that became part of the Communicative Arts Academy was about that tall and about that wide. He was in high school. He never said anything to anyone. He just drew. We at this institution built a dark room from scratch. All the trays were fiberglass. We did all the plumbing, and the room was about as big as this area right here. So it was a huge dark room. The young man's name is Willie Middlebrook. I don't know if you know his name. Willie went into that dark room and never came out. He's one of the most respected photographers in the country right now. Just had two major works collected by the Art Institute, right? Could have become a gang member very easily. Absolutely. This is before the times of the Crips and the Piru, I mean the Crips and the Bloods and all that. This is another period before that time. But what I'm saying is, like, I was given the responsibility of developing a program. I was also given the responsibility of renovating this huge arena-like building. And I did that as best I could so that we could facilitate a program. And I had been in that building for probably 4-5 years, and I knew the building inside and out, the plumbing, the electricity, just everything. One day, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm in this very familiar place. And I had built out of scrap material a small house in this large arena out of old scrap wood. And this was supposed to be the inner coffee house. It was an average sized structure, like a two bedroom house that big in this arena. It was made out of scrap material. One wall was made out of piano harps for the musicians. It had a stage. And at the time, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, I am finishing up a ceiling that's going in this house. I'm putting in a tie-dyed parachute with a light source on the other side so it really looked like a sky. I was feeling good about that. And all of a sudden, something very strange happened. I'm in the little house on a ladder, and I heard something outside of the house that said, tap, 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 tap. Who was that? Hello? Doom, 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 doom. And I felt that, right? So, wow, what's that? I'm too new to California to be knowing everything that I should know about earthquakes, but I said, maybe it's an earthquake. So I came down off of the ladder, went outside of the little house into the big arena, and all of a sudden, way up in the top of the arena, ding, 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 roam. There was a play set, a theatrical set in the building. All of a sudden, that started to shake. And then on the stage, bam, 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 bam. Back at the little house again, and the sound was moving all over the place, and I said, I am insane. I have been working too hard. That's what I said to myself, because nobody else is in the building. I said, nobody would ever believe this. So what I did was, I backed away from the sound. I went all the way up to the front of the building where there was a pay telephone, and I picked up the pay telephone, and I called the office, which was a block away, and I asked the co-director, Judson Powell, musician, actor, painter, Judson, this is Bridge. Something very strange is taking place in the building. Would you come around and be with me? I don't know what this is. And so Judson was there in 2 minutes. I held him at bay. Dancer came in to start her rehearsals. I held them at bay, and I told them precisely what had occurred. One of the secretaries also came with Judson. We all went back into the large room at the same time. And I was so relieved, because as soon as we got in the large room, well above us was this tapping. And then all of a sudden, you heard it move way across the other, one of the other corners, this corner. There was a tapping, thumping, and a monstrous sound. We did not know what that was. So, one thing that I walked away with that day was that there is a lot of power, and there are forces around us that we simply cannot interpret at times. That was one. And what I thought was, after I really sat down and reevaluated what occurred that afternoon, we had hosted a funeral in that building a few months before of a great lady from Cuba who practiced black magic. You know what I mean? And we as artists created to accommodate that funeral because her children, her family, did not want to host the funeral in the church. Okay? So they came to us and asked us if we would accommodate their mother's funeral. And she was a great lady who everybody loved. I mean, there was nothing that you just didn't love about her. She was wonderful. And the musicians wrote compositions for Mama Dodi. The poets wrote about life, and life continuum for Mama Dodi. And the visual artist, we got parachutes and tie-dyed them and created these great wings that went all the way up in the dome of the building. And we put light sources on the other side, and they actually flew right across the building, you know, huge. And all of the elderly women, especially in the community, came to us, and I'm seeing around 1971, and they were saying things like, "You can't have a funeral in here. You can't have carries for y'all play that jazz music in here. And this ain't no place to have no funeral, right?" So we got a little leery, but on the day of the funeral, there were thousands of people who knew her who came. The fire department came. There were council people there. The mayor came. City of Compton. The police department came, and the place was just packed. So we knew that we had done something right. But it did occur to us that strange incident occurred after that fact, and that we could have witnessed the energy of Mama Dodi simply coming to say thanks, you know? And believe it or not, 3 days after the funeral, the Smithsonian Institute called us and asked us if we had actually accommodated a funeral as an art process. It is documented. And so I felt very comfortable in knowing that the unseen can be very stout. And the unknowledge can be very solid.
That's really, you know, I've always believed that I don't write about necessarily what I know, I write about what I don't know, so that I can figure out what I know. And tapping into these mysteries are absolutely essential. That's in the context of poetry, maybe not in the context of fiction or prose. Some people might think, but there is this energy that I don't think is as natural as that light.
Sure.
And, I know you seem to have grown up in a superstitious household too, on some level, in which maybe in a world where superstition meant something important. Certainly, I did. I can't remember all the things my mother used to make me do. You know. The way you had to walk through the house, certain things you had to do, you know, mm-hmm. little focus things. And
Lord.
You know, they're just things that she learned. And I probably still do them. Because they mean something.
Yeah.
And every time I have an experience like that, which I always seem to have when I'm really at the peak of my work, mm-hmm. I'm really glad I never quit.
I've had it, so. But I always thought that I was a little off balance. You know what I mean? I got comfortable with that. But this afternoon, the afternoon that occurred, I just wanted wanted to make sure that I called some people who were close at hand, because I couldn't afford to witness that alone.
Sure.
I would have been in bad shape if nobody had shown up.
Yeah. You know, I've been waiting for tonight, and tomorrow night is the peak of the Leonid meteor showers. And I'm really not, you can't see the sky here, can you, because of the fog, right? It's terrible. It's the same as San Francisco. I thought, well, come to L.A., the fog will be gone.
What are the Leonid meteor showers?
Well, it's one of the great mysteries.
Right? Yeah.
Because, well, probably have to go up to the observatory. But I remember as a child when I first saw these things, I had a similar experience to what you just experienced.
Yeah.
I didn't know what this was. You ever had that? Looking up at the sky, and all of a sudden, these things start falling out of the sky. And these big white claw marks keep, you know, racing across. Yeah. It's pretty incredible. But there's one tonight, peaks tonight at 2 a.m. Tomorrow night, look up around Orion. And you can see the three Orion stars real clearly right now. Mm-hmm. And if you looked at that around 2 a.m., you'd see these things. And, you know, all this is, scientifically, supposedly, is the atmosphere of the Earth spinning into the passing stream of cosmic dust, probably meteoric dust of a comet. And so that causes sparks, these stars, to fall into the atmosphere and burn. Mm-hmm. These dust, and these rocks. And lately I've been thinking that that's pretty much what it's like to try to be an artist in this society. Keep drifting into
this. Sounds like the lie going into John's soul.
That's right.
Mm. Yeah, that's a beautiful linkage.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any questions? I think we're kind of pulling to a close here. Does anybody have any questions?
I do, for John. I went to a craft fair over the weekend. Mm. And at craft fairs, we see all kinds of art and what some people hope is art. And was there a time when you found yourself going from making stuff and being a craftsperson of one sort or another, and then finding yourself, like in this wonderful book that you shared with us, published and a recognized fine artist? What was the transition period? What happened for you to make that transition?
I really can't say that I know, because I grew up around craftsmen that I love so much. I grew up around people like Mr. Black, who made shoes for the person. And he was a good friend of my father's. And he was big, tall man who looked more Italian maybe than African American. Big, heavy mustache and always a cigar hanging out of his head. And he rolled his sleeves up. I mean, that was his personality. That was just the way he looked. And his shop had a smell. It had a sound, all the machinery. And he made shoes. He made shoes. Beautiful shoes. And so I remember what an interesting thing for me as a kid growing up, watching him tap away and turn on this machine to cut, and this one would sew and whatnot. And sometimes it was hand stitching, right? I also grew up in the South with people who made buckets. My grandfather was a basket weaver. You know what I mean? So there was something to be appreciated about the mind that tells a hand what to do, not just the hand. But, you know, like a fine craftsman has a mind that cultivates a hand, because we all have hands, but we all don't use them as Charlie Parker used his. You know the way he, it's impossible. The mind bleeds through. It's all connected, you know. And so I think that what we appreciate as a fineness in art is a craft. It has to do with how the sensibility becomes piece of the architecture and the architectural process. For me, it is. You know, I think I find it difficult to separate one from the other, because we need these separate things. I think there's a piece of fabric. And when you grow into dismantling whatever this experience is so that you can digest just some of it, it all becomes very much connected. It all becomes very, very much connected. This way.
John, I wanted to ask you, you spoke to us about this wonderful child and these wonderful memories and images that you had of this childhood. What are some of the images?
Hold on to?
That you hold on to, or that you see right now.
That I see right now.
That you bring to this art.
Well, for those who might not know my work, and for those who do, some of the materials that I use are foreign to each other. I use a lot of steel. I use wood. I use rag. I always felt that if there's day, for me to really understand day, I must know night, just the opposite,
right?
And then all of the things in between those two extremes, that motivates me a great deal. That's a challenge. Like there's male and female, there's more similarity than contrast, whether we know that or not, you know? And that's wonderful. But it's a challenge to accept that, the way things are today, you know what I mean. So I bring to my work the language of contrast to establish a sense of growth and challenge. But I remember also great old ladies who hung around my neck medicines that were in little bags that they used to call asphidity bags. And when they hung them around your neck, this necklace made out of little square bags that they tediously patched and sewed together, and they put all of the stuff inside, and these bags would start to change color. But if you had this bad cold, the cold somehow was absorbed by the bags, and they had strong odor. And they ultimately ended up being brown, like old wood or something. And they were very beautiful to me. So when you see my work, sometimes you see those little bags. They're the same bags that you see downtown Los Angeles when a great building grows up and touches the California sky, and there's a little lady who sleeps down. Was courageous enough to challenge the light, to be with that. I'm really sensitive in regard to things like that. So every now and then, images like that will pop up in my work. You know, I remember old men who hung things in trees, right? Bottles, tin cans. I don't know why. They put colored water in the bottles at times. That was very beautiful to me. That was having a Christmas tree all the time, you know? And when the winds would blow, you would hear them make music because the bottles would bump and ring. And the house that I grew up in was about as big as this table, but I didn't know that then. And it had a tin roof. And when it would rain, the roof made music for me. It was rhythmic, it was tonal. It was beautiful. It was like an a cappella choir at times. And so I have difficulty separating the idioms. I also bring as many images from my past because I'm attached in that way. And it will also get me into whatever my future used to be because it's all connected.
It's hard to hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. I have to say that that's very exciting. I'm very familiar with your work, and I know that those images of your past those sounds that are AKAs, are those images seeping through your work too? Because, you know, if you look at just the surface, you see the past. But I know that you can't, I mean, that you have to pull away and you see all of these other things and you burn yourself and yourself is part of you can't stand right now.
Yeah, I do. I was director of the Watts Towers Art Center for almost 70 years. And I got to know a lot of intellectual gang members. I got to know kids that I'd have to collect guns in the morning while they were on the way to school. And that was an arrangement between me and the kid. You know what I mean? That started to happen a long time ago. I have experienced being locked up in a house with gang members, and the rug was rolled up on the floor so if they had to take me out, no blood could get on the floor, on the rug. You know what I mean? I mean, I've had those kind of experiences. So I see that as nothing but part of a garment that I've had the good fortune to wear momentarily, but not necessarily part of who I am. But because I'm so tangible to all of this, I find myself making notes about those kind of things. And the AK-47 that I hear in the street, my daughter and I right now, I'm making walls that remind you of the environment. The building that gets painted in splotches because it's painting out the graffiti, and it ends up being very interesting because it's always in transition. That is introducing itself in my work. The unreadable language at times, the hieroglyphics that I find interesting to untangle. So being that my daughter is a poet, and she's a very sensitive writer, and I'm very happy about that. I'm making these walls, and she will graffiti them with her poetic gesture, you know, and so I do try to remain as current as I can.
Well,
so,
thank you.
Yeah, thank you both so very, very much. Thank you all very much.